Hi, and welcome to The Art of Fatherhood. I'm Kenton Biffert, and today we're going to address a hot topic. The question, is gender actually fluid? Can gender change? Can you be one day male, the next day female? Can I walk into a bathroom today as a male, and the next day decide I'm female and walk into there, or somewhere in between? I was reading a document from a school board on their inclusion program for individuals who are having difficulties with their gender expression. And they gave some definitions, which I find very interesting. And we'll start off here with their definitions. One, sex. The definition of sex is simply what you are assigned at birth. So based on your reproductive organs. Two, gender identity. What you feel that you are on the inside, which could be either male, female, both, neither, I have no clue how that's possible, or somewhere in between. So we have a separation between sex and gender, according to this document. Now there are three premises that this document is working from. The first one is that our body and soul are not one, are not unified. Two, that our soul has a gender, or can have a gender of some sort. And three, that gender of the soul is fluid. I'm simply going to use the teachings of St. Thomas Aquinas, and we're going to answer these three conclusions, these three premises of this document, and prove them all to be absolute fallacy. Let's begin. The first one, the body and soul are not one. Now this goes all the way back to Descartes. I think, therefore I am. I am a thinking thing. Well, he was wrong. And it's because we are our bodies. We are a body and soul unity together. Without that, we aren't. You can think about it this way. When you came into being, the sperm and the egg came together, and the matter was therefore sufficient to create a human being. At that moment, God created a soul, a human rational soul, and informed that matter with that soul, and we have a human being. But the only reason that God created a soul at that exact moment was because the sperm and the egg came together. Because there was the matter for a human being. Without that matter, there was no soul to be created. So to suggest that I am what I am on the inside, and I'm not my body doesn't express who I am because I am something different on the inside, is hogwash, actually. It can't be that way, because you wouldn't exist if you didn't have a body in the first place. You are your body. Your body expresses who you are on the inside. In fact, your body even goes so much to define who you are as a human, male or female. You are your body. This separation of body and soul can't work. We are one. A good example for your children, or an example that I give children, is if you take a sponge and it's hard and dry, and you take that sponge and you plunge it into water. Every part of that sponge is now completely saturated with water. That is how our soul totally saturates our body and is so unified. In fact, it's even more so entwined in every hair and fingernail and every part of my body. My soul is there and I am one. I am my body and my soul. There's no juxtaposition between the two. Impossible. Second question, does our soul have a gender? And it's a good question, because it seems because men and women are so different and they think so differently that maybe they have a masculine soul and a feminine soul. Well, again, that's not correct. It can be explained this way. The soul is what informs the matter to make it a living thing. So if you have a plant, so we'll go with Aristotle here, which St. Thomas Aquinas adopts, that there's three types of souls. You have the plant soul, the plant, that spark of life that vivifies the plant, causes it to grow. It's also called a nutritive soul. It gives it its nature to grow and produce leaves and fruit and so forth. That's the plant soul. The animal soul, or the sensual soul, the type of soul that when informing matter, it allows them to have senses and to see and smell. And we have that in the animal kingdom. And then there's the rational soul, which we humans have. And we have all, and humans have aspects of this vegetative soul, this nutritive soul, the sensual soul, and the rational soul. We're all of that, right? Now, back to the question. Does soul have a gender? Now, the soul, not only does it bring life to the matter, that spark of life, but it also defines the species. All animals have an animal soul, and the animal soul, when placed into the matter of a beaver, into a beaver body, you get what that beaver needs and all its senses to survive, and you have a beaver instinct in a body and you have a beaver. The animal soul, which again enlivens the senses in a living being, put into a lion's body, and then you have a lion. Well, same thing with humans. A rational soul is the species. We as humans are rational animals, as Aristotle tells us. And that soul, when put into a human body, vivifies that body. Now, there's two ways of being human, two modes of being human, and that's male and female. But there's one species of humanity. All humans have a rational soul. So there's no human soul, or there's no male soul and no female soul. There's just a rational soul that we all have, and two modes of being human, male and female. However, when my soul was given to my body at conception by God, okay, I have a male body, and my soul was given to me, my male body then begins to inform my soul, or form my soul, or is a horrible word, but genderize my soul, if you want, or masculinize my soul. Because my body, and it's all my Y chromosome, my testosterone, and everything that comes with that, aggression, competition, everything that the Y chromosome produces, muscle mass, all of that begins to inform how I think, and how I act, and how I learn, and how I fight, and how I play. My body informs who I am. So the soul itself does not have a gender. However, your soul is masculinized, is feminized by your body. Again, going back to this tight unity between body and soul. The third question, which is should be obvious by now, is gender fluid? Well, the answer is obvious. Obviously, it cannot be, because if the soul doesn't have a gender, then you can't be changing your gender. It's not fluid. You can sum it up this way: once a man, always a man. Once a woman, always a woman. A man cannot become a woman. It is impossible. Because even though they may cut and tuck and choose to wear women's clothes and put on lipstick and get a high voice and change their hormones, the fact of the matter is that every single cell in their body has a Y chromosome and they are male. And that masculinity is informing their soul, so they will always, always be male. This idea that your gender can change with how you feel is hogwash. It can't happen. Now, how do we address this in society is a good question. Because there are people that feel that they are female on the inside when they have a male body, or vice versa. And we have to, because they are a human person and they are infinitely precious and have such a great dignity, there has to be a high respect for them, and there has to be a love and a charity and a show of understanding. However, this charity that we show them can't be providing them a lie to help them live their life. The second thing we need to do is to stand up against these government policies that are trying to defend the rights based on how people feel on the inside. That is ridiculous. Rights are based on the dignity of the human person. Because you are a human being, you have a set of rights. That's what it's grounded in. Now, if a person feels like they're female one day, or neither, or both, or somewhere in between, and all this stuff, there's no rights that go along with that. I may feel like a cheese sandwich tomorrow. I get no rights based on that. That is completely irrelevant, because rights are based simply in the dignity of the human person. So we have to fight for that against these government policies. And the third thing, which is by far the best, we need to celebrate masculinity and femininity in its perfection, which is fatherhood and motherhood. Celebrate fatherhood and motherhood, because that's where we find the perfection, the fulfillment of our natures as man and woman. If you've enjoyed this session or have some comments to make on it, which I'm sure some of you do, I'd be happy to hear from you, or join me on my website at theartoffatherhood.ca. Remember, be always faithful to your God and to your faith and to your family. This is Kentony Biffert, Semper Fidelis.